So, good morning, class. This is the second part of the continuation of contraception class. For the convenience sake, I divided this into three parts, but as per the instructions given, we'll start contraception with this class only. The next third part will be revise it later if we have time. And in the previous class, we have discussed about the barrier methods and IUCDs. Now, we are going to discuss about emergency contraceptions, combined oral contraceptive pills and their advantages, the side effects and contraindications. Combined oral contraceptive pills also include triphasic pills. And then coming to the next topic would be progesterone only pills. Next, the newer variants, depot injections, subdermal implants, allostatic vaginal rings and transdermal patches. All this will be discussed. And the last topic would be on male contraception. The female part sterilization and male sterilization, if we have time, we'll discuss. Otherwise, that will be shifted to a separate class. Coming to emergency contraception, it is also called post-coital contraception or interception because they interfere only with the post-ovulatory events. That is indicated in the case of rape, unprotected intercourse, when the IUCD is misplaced or the woman forgets to take her pill. It is just a backup method and it is not used as a regular method of contraception. So how to take an emergency contraception? One tablet of levonorgestrel of 1.5 milligram dose is taken within 72 hours or 3 days of unprotected intercourse. And the name given to it is called IPE pill. Previously, it was available over the counter, but because of the misuse, this drug has been banned. And alternatively, one tablet of levonorgestrel dose 0.75 milligrams and another tablet that has to be taken 12 hours later. This also protects equal efficacy, but the failure rate in both the methods is 1.1 by 100 women years. So if the levonorgestrel pills are not available, the routine contraceptive pills, combined oral pills can also be taken, but two tablets have to be taken with a dose of 100 micrograms of ethinyl estradiol. In the routine OC pills, we have only 50, 30 or 20 micrograms of ethinyl estradiol. But for the emergency contraception, we have to use a dose of around 100 micrograms, that is two tablets of ethinyl estradiol we have to take with a combination of 1 milligrams of norethisterone or 500 micrograms of levonorgestrel. Same, 3 days within the unprotected intercourse time, followed by two tablets taken 12 hours later. This regimen is called UHP regimen and the failure rate is around 3.2 per 100 women years. Alternate tablets, if the OC pills, levonorgestrel are not available, the other drugs which are used are mifepristone or RU486. This doesn't prevent fertilization but blocks the action of progesterone and the endometrium. The dosage is 25 to 50 milligrams. Single dose tablet is sufficient. Next is uliprostol. It is another variant. It is a progesterone receptor modulator. It attaches to the progesterone receptor and it also delays ovulation and prevents implantation and brings about an atrophic changes in the endometrium. Here also single dose tablet is efficient, that is 30 milligrams tablet single dose. It has to be taken within 3 to 5 days of unprotected intercourse. Cenpromen, it is a non-hormonal contraceptive. It also prevents implantation, but here two tablets has to be taken twice daily within 24 hours of exposure. Other drugs which are used are GnRH agonist and IUCDs. IUCD should be introduced within 5 days of unprotected intercourse. How did this act? The mode of action is these hormones, they delay ovulation, bring about corpus luteolysis and they form a thick cervical mucus plug and the progesterone brings about endometrial atrophy. This as well as prevents ovulation, implantation and delay fertilization. Second category is combined oral contraceptive pills. From now, we have only four generations. First generation is a combination of ethinyl estradiol. And here the ethinyl estradiol, the drug is common, but the dosage is reduced. And coming to the subsequent generations, the progesterogen combination, progesterogen combination differs. First generation is ethinyl estradiol combination with norethindrone. Second generation is ethinyl estradiol with a combination of norgestrel or levonorgestrel. थर्ड जनरेशन इज इथेनॉल एस्ट्रैडियोल प्लस डिसोजेस्टरल जेस्टोडीन और नॉरजेस्टामिन एंड फोर्थ जनरेशन इज इथेनॉल एस्ट्रैडियोल एंड ड्रॉस्पिरिनोल. So these two drugs, Mala N and Mala D, these are supplied, out of which Mala N is supplied free, of course, by the government of India. Mala D contains 0.5 milligrams of D-norgestrel. It is a 28 blister pack, out of which 21 will be the drug dosage, and the rest of the 7 tablets are iron tablets or vitamin capsules. How do these combined oral contraceptive pills act? The drug has to be taken on the second day or the third day of the menstrual cycle, assuming the woman is having 28 days regular menstrual cycle. These drugs, the estrogen component of the combined oral contraceptive pill, it suppresses pituitary hormones and decreases the FSH. And as a result, the FSH, there will be suppression of the FSH, there will be no follicular growth. And the progesterone component of the combined oral contraceptive pill brings about a suppression of LH peak, bringing an ovulation. In addition to that, the progesterone also causes atrophic changes in the endometrium. It makes the cervical mucus plug thick, making it impermeable for sperm penetration. And also, it increases the tubal motility, so the fertilized egg, if any, reaches the uterine cavity before the endometrium is receptive for implantation. So when to start the pill? In a regular non-lactating or non-pregnant woman, the pill has to be started on the day 2 or day 3 of the cycle. Suppose the woman has conceived, given birth to a child, and if she is not lactating, the oral pills can be started as soon as 3 weeks after delivery. If the woman is breastfeeding her child, the pill has to be started after 6 months. As soon as the woman starts off weaning to her child, she has to start the OC pills. And other indications, so the woman can take soon after abortion, soon after MTP, ectopic pregnancy, and following hydatidiform mole evacuation. Only if the serum beta HCG is negative, the drug has to be prescribed. What are the advantages? Apart from the contraceptive benefits, these pills bring about the regularization of the menstrual cycle, the bleeding reduces, and the cycles are. The bleeding is also reduced in amount, and the duration of the cycle is also reduced. It effectively controls fertility. By virtue of non-ovulation, it relieves dysmenorrhea and PMS. Because of the ovulatory changes only, the women will complain of dysmenorrhea, premenstrual symptoms. As there is no ovulation, no LH peak, the woman doesn't complain of any PMS or dysmenorrhea in her menstrual cycle, because all the cycles induced by COC pills are non-ovulatory cycles. And it prevents anemia by reducing the menstrual blood loss. In addition to this, it lowers the incidence of benign breast diseases, that is fibrocystic disease of the breast, reduces the incidence of functional ovarian cyst. The cyst size should be less than 5 to 8 centimeters. And they also, regular use of oral contraceptive pills are protective for ovarian cancers and uterine cancers. And the effect of this lasts as long as 10 years after stopping the drug. And incidence of PID is reduced. Why the PID is reduced? Because the cervical mucus plug is formed, preventing the ascending infections. And also it reduces the incidence of ectopic pregnancy. Other benefits are they protect against rheumatoid arthritis, they reduce the risk of anorectal cancers. These fourth generation pills, which we discussed, we'll be discussing later, they also cure acne, PCOS, and endometriosis. So when not to prescribe the OC pills? The side effects and contraindications for the OC pills will be, women will complain of intermenstrual spotting even after taking the pills. General reassurance is sufficient. The woman may complain of post-pill amenorrhea, oligomenorrhea, and hypernumeria. That is also reassured. And there is increased chance of monilal vaginitis with the use of combined oral contraceptive pills. Symptomatic management is sufficient. And these combined pills, they bring about the suppression of lactation because of the estrogen component on the COC pills. So in the women who are lactating, progesterone-only pills have to be prescribed instead of the COC pills. And the drugs has to be prescribed with caution in a patient with history of liver adenoma. These do not protect against STDs and HIVs. And one more important thing we have to remember while prescribing the COC pills, we have to thoroughly take a history of thromboembolism history in the patients, because the risk of thromboembolism is more with the drugs containing disoproxil and gestrel. Thromboembolism and OC pills will be a short note question for you. The thromboembolism and OC pills, why they bring about the thromboembolic changes? Because there will be increased chances of pulmonary embolism and cerebral thrombosis. Both venous and arterial are more frequent in pill users within the first year of use. This is because of the increased clotting mechanism, platelet aggregation, increased fibrinogen usage, factor 7 and 8 usage, and decreased fibrinolysis. The estrogen component is responsible for thromboembolism and it is dose dependent. So the subsequent generation of pills, the estrogen dose has come down to as low as 20 micrograms to reduce the side effects of thromboembolism. So the high risk group where the COC pills have to be prescribed with caution are women who are over 40 years, those who have a history of stroke, and patients who are heavy smokers, alcoholics, cardiac and hypertensive patients, familial hyperlipoproteinemia, those who have a history of liver disease, and the patients who are grossly obese. They should not be prescribed COC pills. These are some relative and absolute contraindications for that. The pills containing disoproxil and gestrel, they should not be prescribed with patients who have a history of thromboembolism because they carry a higher risk compared to other COC pills. And these drugs are contraindicated. These are absolute contraindications, sickle cell anemia and the family history of breast cancer. You should not prescribe COC pills. Whenever you prescribe a COC pill, you have to take a pap smear prior before to check on a cervical dysplasia. And here are the few drugs which should not be co-prescribed with COC pills because these COC pills reduce the efficacy of these drugs. The drugs are rifampicin, antiretroviral drugs like ritonavir, tetracyclines, anticonvulsants, especially sodium valproate, antifungals, cephalosporins, and phenobarbitone. So these drugs should not be co-prescribed with COC pills. What happens if the woman happens to miss a pill? This is also a short note question for you. If one tablet is missed, the woman is no longer adequately protected and she has to use a barrier method for the rest of the cycle. And she has to take the pill as soon as she remembers. And the next pill has to be taken on the same day, same time. And the next day she has to take the pill regularly according to the same time. So if the person misses a pill, she has to take two tablets the same day and another tablet at the regular time. Majority of failure rate is due to failure to take the pill regularly. So with the OC pills, the failure rate is 0.1 per 100 women years. The failure rate is mainly because of the non-compliance of the patient to take the pill regularly. So when can we expect the fertility to return normally after stopping the drug? 99% of the women will have normal menstrual cycle within 6 months of stopping the pill, and it is slightly delayed due to delay in the ovulation, return of ovulation. No evidence of fetal malformations or increased risk of abortion is seen in those who conceive while on pill. 90% ovulate within 3 months of stopping the drug. This is triphasic pills is one of the variant of combined oral contraceptive pills. This has to be prescribed in a woman who have relative contraindications with COC pills, like women with hypertensive cardiac history or myocardial infarction history. Triphasic pills can be prescribed for them. This is a combination of ethylene estradiol and levonorgestrel. It is a blister pack containing different color combinations. See, 5 packs. 5, another 10 yellow color, and the green color pack is a multivitamin or an iron pack. The first 5 days, the dosage is 30 micrograms of ethinyl estradiol plus 50 micrograms of levonorgestrel for 6 days. Next, for the next 5 days, we have 40 micrograms of ethinyl estradiol plus 75 micrograms of levonorgestrel for the rest 5 days. And for the rest 10 days, 30 micrograms of ethinyl estradiol plus 125. Here, the progesterone, the dose is increased, 125 micrograms levonorgestrel, and the next is pill-free period for 7 days. These pills have no adverse effect on carbohydrate or lipid metabolism, and these are indicated for the high-risk groups as previously discussed, women with history of diabetes, hypertension, previous history of MI, obese patients. But apart from this non-contraceptive benefits like COC pills, this trifosic pills doesn't offer any non-contraceptive pills. It doesn't treat menorrhagia, it doesn't relieve dysmenorrhea, and it does not relieve the women of PMS. Coming to fourth generation pills, which are now used worldwide, and they are more commonly prescribed for the young girls with PCOS. There are two variants. First is ethinyl-estradiol combination of 20 micrograms plus drosperinone. The commercial names are Yasmin, Tarana, and Genya. Second generation is ethinyl-estradiol plus ciproterone acetate or dianate. It has a slightly increased dose of ethinyl-estradiol, 35 micrograms. Why drosperinone is gaining importance? Because it is this analog of spironolactone. It has both anti-mineralocorticoid properties and anti-androgenic properties. As a result, the young girls will be relieved of acne, hirsutism, unwanted hair, and the women will also, they will tell they have a decreased weight gain with the usage of OC pills, but with these fourth generation pills. Whereas the women with the regular OC pills, they complain of bloating, and increased weight gain, chest heaviness with the combined OC pills. So these fourth generation pills are counteracting all the side effects of COC pills. So these pills are gaining importance now. What are the advantages of the fourth generation pills over the conventional pills? It inhibits ovulation, they cure acne, hirsutism. They also reduce water and sodium retention. As a result, there will be no bloating, no chest heaviness, no increase in weight gain with the usage of pills. And there will be no adverse effect on bone mineral density. They prevent obesity and maintain a good lipid profile. But these drugs are also contraindicated with history of liver and renal disease and history of thromboembolism. So to counteract the effect of the estrogen side effects, only progesterone-gen pills are used. These progesterone-gen pills are in various forms like oral pills, intramuscular injections. They are available in the form of implants, patches, vaginal rings, and Mirena IUCD. The one which is commonly used for lactating women are Minipill or POP pill, and it contains either a combination of norethisterone, norgestrol, or levonorgestrel. These are introduced to avoid the side effects of estrogen. The tablet, before prescribing a mini pill, you have to make sure that the woman must take the pill regularly 3 hours prior to the sexual act, because it takes at least 3 hours to form a cervical mucus plug to prevent descent of the sperm. So the woman has to take the pill regularly at bedtime 3 hours prior to the act of coitus. That has to be counseled before prescribing the drug. The tablet has to be taken daily without a break, and it is taken within 5 to 7 days of menstruation, taken same time each day. The advantages are, as previously discussed, these are well suited for lactating mother, women over 35 years, those who have history of focal migraine, and those who have an intolerance to estrogen. And moreover, these POP pills increases the milk secretion. These are the drug of choice in sickle cell anemia. The failure rate is 2 to 3 per 100 woman years. How do they act? They act by suppressing ovulation, they form a thick cervical mucus plug, they increase tubal peristalsis, and they have no androgenic effects. What are the drawbacks with the POC pills? POP pills? The POP pill, as I previously told, strict daily compliance is a must if the patient uses these drugs. And patients do complain of irregular bleeding, amenorrhea, depression, headache, migraine, weight gain, ectopic pregnancy, and small functional ovarian cysts. These can be managed symptomatically, no need to stop the drug. And these drugs has to be contraindicated if the woman has a previous history of ectopic pregnancy, previous history of large ovarian cysts, and history of breast and genital cancer. So if the woman feels a little difficulty to take the pill regularly, we can advise them to switch over to Depot injections. Depot injections, we have two variants. One is Depot Metroxy Progesterone Acetate 150 milligrams, which has to be taken every 3 months, or Norethisterone Enanthate 200 milligrams, which has to be taken every 2 months. Or if they have any compliance with irregular bleeding or amenorrhea, we can co-prescribe them with 5 milligrams of ethinyl estradiol, which is a monthly injection. The contraceptive effect of DMP lasts longer than norethisterone. The injection should be started within a month of delivery in non-lactating and during third month in lactating women. The failure rate is 0.4 per 100 women years with the DMPA and 0.6 per 100 women years with norethisterone in NATHE. What are the advantages over the conventional pills? These DPOS injections are easy to administer and the patient doesn't worry about missing the pill. The compliance is good and women remains under good regular medical supervision. And DMPA is least androgenic and has no side effects on lipid and carbohydrate metabolism. And it is suitable for lactating women. The incidence of PID, ectopic pregnancy, functional ovarian cysts, and endometrial cancers is low. They avoid estrogenic side effects. And DMPA is a drug of choice in patients with sickle cell anemia and sickle cell crisis. And it is coital independent. Only one disadvantage is DMPA is osteopenia. It causes other disadvantages like breakthrough bleeding and amenorrhea. The return of fertility is slightly delayed. Like other OCPs, it also doesn't protect against STDs and HIV. It reduces bone density mass and induced osteopenia. It decreases libido and causes dry vagina. There may be reports of weight gain, depression, bloating, and mastalgia with patients using DMPA. Failure rate here is 0.4% per 100 women years. So some people make it difficult to take injections because these are oil injections and these DPOS injections are slightly painful and patient may complain of abscesses over the site of injections. So in those patients, we can prescribe subdermal implants. Subdermal implant, the site is around the medial aspect of the upper arm. See, this is inserted with the help of a local anesthetic. They cause a slow, sustained release and long-acting drug with reduced side effects. And these drugs avoid the first-pass metabolism and they doesn't affect the liver metabolism. They reduce the frequency of visit to clinics and ensure the even release of hormone. There are two variants. Norplant 1 is Implanon. Norplant 2 is called ZL. It contains a single rod which delivers around 70 micrograms of levonorgestrel. Daily release only 50 micrograms and it provides contraceptive efficacy up to 3 to 5 years. Same like other drugs like DPOTs and COC pills or POP pills, these implants are to be inserted on the first day of menstrual cycle or within 5 days of abortion or 3 weeks after delivery in lactating or non-lactating women. In lactating, this has to be prescribed, inserted on the medial aspect, and this is non-biodegradable, so these implants have to be replaced every 5 years. The advantages are coital independent, no systemic side effects. They are suitable for lactating women and suitable over the women over age of 40. The failure rate is 0.2 to 1.3 per 100 women years. Only one disadvantage is they cause local infection at the site of insertion and they will patient will complain of irregular cycles and intermenstrual spotting. And one more disadvantage is the cost of these implants is around 10,000 per insertion, which is pretty much costly in Indian scenario. These are same like vaginal rings. Coming to vaginal rings, these rings are similar to the vaginal pessaries we prescribe in women who have prolapse and in inoperable conditions of prolapse. Each stylistic ring measures around 50 to 75 mm in diameter and it is 5 to 9 mm thick. It releases a low dose of levonorgestrel, 20 micrograms and 50 micrograms of ethinyl estriol per day. The contraceptive effect is mainly forming a mucus plug over the cervix and it has to be kept in situ for 3 weeks and removed after 1 week. Two variants are there. The commercial names are Nova Ring and Nestron. The advantages are the patient no need to come to clinic, no need to take a medical assistance. She can self-insert the vaginal ring. The compliance is good and the return of fertility is also very good. Only one disadvantage, same like the implants, it is also expensive. One ring costs around 700 per ring and they cause local irritation. The chances of expulsion are more if there is improper technique is followed while insertion and it doesn't have any systemic side effects. As Mirena, the barrier contraceptive, I'm not going to discuss because it was discussed in previous class. This is a hormone releasing IUCD which has to be inserted within 5 days of unprotected intercourse. Or the same like the other OC pills, we have to be taken on the first day of the cycle or 3 weeks after delivery or 6 months after delivery in non-lactating women. The other variant is skin patches, and it is a new drug. The patch eludes 150 micrograms of nalgestromine and 20 micrograms of phenylestradiol daily. Same like vaginal ring, the patches are four patches are required for each menstrual cycle. Three patches are required and applied within 5 days of menstruation over the buttocks and abdomen, where they should not be applied over the breast. The failure rate is 1 to 2.8 per 100 women years. These are the important contraceptives. Other drugs which can be prescribed are GnRH, Enalox, percutaneous gel, and Centromin. Coming to male contraception, this is the last topic. Previously, Gossypol was used. The first male contraceptive was described in China. It is an yellow pigment isolated from cottonseed oil, and a 10 to 20 milligram dosage is used for 3 months, then followed by 20 micrograms twice a week. It acts directly on the seminiferous tubule, inhibiting spermatogenesis without altering FSH and LH levels. The side effect, the most important side effect with Gossypol is hypokalemia. As a result, the male partners are generally not at all feasible to take the contraception. So the woman has to take the burden of contraception. The male contraceptives are generally not at all used by males. The only one acceptable contraception by males is only vasectomy till now. It's only for the theoretical purpose I'm telling. There are four variants of male contraceptive drugs that presently at use. First is norethisterone enanthate. It is a 200 milligram injection weekly, and it causes azoospermia within 1 year. It takes as long as 1 year to bring about azoospermia. So meanwhile, the patient has to take a barrier method of contraception until he becomes azoospermic. Next is testosterone bisacolate. The dose is 600 milligrams. It has to be taken every 3 months. Next is testosterone deconate. It is 1000 milligrams IM dose, followed by 500 milligrams taken every monthly. Next is testosterone implant. It is 200 milligram implant with 300 microgram meprate thrice a month. Other drugs which are used but not used effectively by are GnRH, Enalox, medroxyprogesterone estate, disogestrol. They cause hormone suppression by spermatogenesis, and they cause loss of libido and toxic. Thank you.